3, 2, 1. Welcome to NFT Con. Fuck!
God damn it, RB! It's literally 1 year. That's it, folks. 1 year. It's Hardcore Nerdcore Wrestling stood for 1 year before we completely sold out.
Fuck!
Awesome.
Tony Khan bought us. I'm sorry. Wait, hold on. I have a paper here. Oh, turns out Tony Khan didn't buy it. He bought Ring of Honor. I misread that as Tony Khan bought Hardcore Nerdcore Wrestling. Also, we're doing NFTs now. Sorry. That's what I got the con from. I misspelled con. Anyway, it's Hardcore Nerdcore Wrestling. I'm here with my co-commentator, Ernie. You got anything to add? Yeah. You got anything to add?
Only the fact that finding out a celebrity you love saying they're getting into NFTs, a bit like finding out your friend is saying they're getting into Attack on Titan. Yeah, if there's something about you that feels bad, but I think there's just the number is just too staggering for you to just completely cut them off, because then you'll be miserable. So you just kind of have to begrudgingly look at it as the sort of the quiet part of y'all's relationship.
Yeah.
That and also the Control Your Narrative promotion gonna be a fucking shit show, and I can't wait.
Oh yes.
Oh my god. Or as I've heard some people call it, MAGA Elite Wrestling.
Oh god.
Or no, is it MAGAL Elite Wrestling? Whichever. Oh.
I forgot to swap over a couple wrestlers for the first match tonight, but in the meantime, you can tell us all about what's going on.
All right, you got it. So hi everyone, it's me, English Ernie. First of all, I'd like to give a congratulations to my cousin Spanish announce team Ernie for sitting in last week. He did a fantastic job. So you know, last week we had our the Sadness Aggravation Deathmatch, the 1 year anniversary of Hardcore Nerdcore Wrestling. And what an anniversary it was. We opened up with the undercard where Eric Sparrow had one of his biggest tests, his first chance at gold against to try and claim Wesker's undercard belt. But Wesker ended up coming out on top. You know, figures a super genetically modified super weapon man and would beat a shitlord skateboarder.
Yeah.
But then the Trios Championship rolled around, and the Fiercest Furs took an emphatic win on Triple G, just with Meowsles just absolutely cracking the skull of Queen Boo. Just clean. I'm surprised ghosts still have any sort of bones, but okay.
You know, ghosts work fucky in the Mario universe.
Yeah, that's fair. Then we had the Tag Team Championship, where it was old meets new. The Baba Wagas taking on Pop Team Epic. And it was an absolute war, but in the end, the new kids on the block, the new hotness, as it were, Pop Team Epic, beating out a Hardcore Nerdcore Wrestling original to defend their tag team belts. And then following that up, in the biggest upset of the night, during the 3KB Championship, Luigi caught Waluigi in the mousetrap and took the 3KB belt off of him. It's a rough night for Waluigi.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, it gets rough from there, because right after that we had the grapplies, which was great. But then after that we had the self-aggrandizement deathmatch. Or the sad.
No, it's the self-aggrandizement. Yeah, yes, you said it right. You just corrected yourself.
So we had, it was a war. We've seen, you know, a lot of bank up performances, you know, saw everybody really dig deep. Some new debutees, which we'll be seeing later tonight. You know, some older competitors are showing they've still ill-gotted. But in the end, it came down to number 69 and number 70, Koyos and Waluigi. And in a, but in a hard-fought tooth-and-nail battle, Koyos was able to eliminate Waluigi and go up next for the Hardcore Nerdcore Wrestling Championship against Sonic the Hedgehog. And Koyos fought as hard as he could, but just the champion was too much for Koyos, and Sonic managed to get another defense, and it's under his, well, belt.
Yeah.
But we've hit it, the start of year two of Hardcore Nerdcore Wrestling. The records, the brackets have been reset. It is a fresh start, Art, and we're going to be coming into this just full force, no prep, just completely and totally raw. Wait, shit, I can't say that's copyright.
Right. Uncooked.
Exactly. So, to start things off for the night, we're going to be opening with a little. We're going to be opening with, you know, just kind of the first match of one of our first debutees. And that is, you know, a classic, nice classic zombie slayer versus zombie slayer. As Zoe from Left 4 Dead is going to be taking on Chris Redfield from Resident Evil.
And let's cut to the match. Let's cut to the ring. Don't fuck me over on this. There we go. Hold on. Okay.
And coming in first is Chris Redfield, who came in early during the self-aggrandizement deathmatch and had, and actually for the longest time, carried the, for a bit, was the one with the most eliminations at the start.
Yep.
Because I think there was somebody else who had it for the longest, but both of those got eclipsed by a certain person, yeah. Which we'll be seeing later.
Ooh, okay, you want to play it like that then.
Yeah. And starting things off is Collage Teen Zoe. Wait, is she? I know she's a college student. Wait,
is she? I don't know. I think she's a film student. Either way, whatever, they're fighting.
Right, so starting things off. Oh, Chris with a big boot. Both of us are pretty, intimately familiar with both games. So from the perspective of the types of undead hordes both have had to go up against, who do you think has the advantage here?
It depends. I think Zoe is kind of used to the zombies coming fast and furious, whereas Chris Redfield appreciates a more methodical approach to things.
Of course.
Yeah, so I mean, he's used to exploring like mansions, working in tight corners. So you get him up close, he has an opportunity, but you give Zoe enough room and she'll pop, 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 pop you up before you know what you're doing, yes. Like that.
Yes. Also, I just checked, there is no list confirmed age for Zoe.
Okay.
Just that she's a college student.
All right, fair enough.
But anyways, tying things up. Also, you gotta wonder what how the mental game is gonna be looking like here right now, because given Fire Pro's absolute stellar sprite work here, one could mistake Zoe right here if you turned your head slightly and squinted a bit for Chris's brother or Chris's sister Claire.
Hmm.
And Zoe just
that's not Freudian at all.
The meme is that he's trying to get her shat act up with someone else. Not that he's trying to sweet home Alabama here.
I'm gonna go with Freudian here.
Okay, fair enough. Alright, so tying up. Oh, nice kick from Zoe. Nice shoulder check. Also kind of looking at this perspective, again, looking at the sort of level of the competitors at the corner. Oh shit, I just realized Ellis is there in the corner.
Yeah.
Huh. Well, that's nice. You know, seeing fellow survivors support one another and stuff.
Well, yeah, you know, you gotta.
You look at him being such a good friend. Oh, Zoe getting sent. And to the corner, though. Oh. Oh, and a Rice reversal by Chris Redfield. You know, Chris Redfield, you know, oh, looking at this right now, looking back at his year, you know, he was definitely a competitor who had a really rough start. You know, definitely probably hoping to maybe get something going this year right now, especially because he was starting to pick up a little bit of momentum during in the later half of the year, but with his showings in Rhythm the Bastarding, you know, the self-aggrandizement deathmatch
and whatnot. Mm-hmm.
So, but he can't rest on his laurels right now, because again, Zoe, he is not just some ordinary film student. She's a survivor for a reason. She's dealt with the likes of the, you know, of just the ferocity of hunters, the trickiness of smokers, the unrelenting force of boomers, and what a backstabber from Zoe. Even having to deal with just the sheer brute strength and the tanks. Oh, but Zoe getting pieced up by Chris Redfield. But again, with all that's being said, that pales in comparison to sort of the types of tyrants that Chris Redfield has had to deal with in his story career. Ooh,
yeah.
And another backstabber. Oh, and Chris Redfield getting caught with a rear naked choke. Oh, but he's able to get out of there. Well, I hope everyone's got their heel spray, A's and first aid kick. It's on deck. Oh, into a calf crusher. Now, Chris really trying to tank through some pains, and what a boulder punch! Oh, Zoe might be knocked out. Ooh, that is a near fall. Just barely able to get up. Oh, she's got some combos of her own. Oh, but Chris is back up, though he looks to be in no man's land right now. Oh, Chris is catching Zoe. Oh, it's stopped to the back of the head. Oh, and Chris just putting on a striking clinic right now. Nice European uppercut. Oh, picking up a Zoe. Oh, small package.
Ooh.
And Chris Redfield with the first win in year two of Hardcore Nerdcore Wrestling.
Oh, I am so glad.
Yeah. And you know, commiserations for Zoe, but you know, a lot of rookies have a rough start here in Hardcore Nerdcore Wrestling.
Yeah. Zoe 1 and 0. Chris 1 and 0. There we go.
That's
so
right,
currently one. For year two, Chris has the best record ever in
Congrats,
Hardcore Nerdcore.
Chris.
Yeah. Congratulations, Chris. Congratulations.
Congratulations.
All right. What do we got next on deck?
Well, next on deck, we're going to be having another rookie debut today. He was in the self-aggrandizing deathmatch, but a singles debut. There we go. Singles debut. As Wario is going to be going up against Toad.
All right.
Wario going up against a familiar face. Definitely looking to be very promising. Really impressed. You know, had some tremendous ring gear coming in, only to be greeted by who is probably best described as like the gatekeeper of the Awoken. And Toad, why they're targeting Wario in particular? I'll be honest, I couldn't say why, but you know, if it's anyone's moment's time to shine right now, it's gonna be Wario's. Let's see what he's got.
Yeah, I mean, Wario is just the ultimate Chad here, and I think I think what you're gonna see is, oh shit, balls on stream. I need to swap over to Discord view, and I'm going to edit the current thing. All right. So yeah, I mean, Wario is just like a pure beefy Chad energy. So Toad, you can't kill Toad. Toad is a very strong habit of not dying.
Surprisingly, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think Wario's going to put on a strong showing here.
Mm-hmm. But again, like you said, Toad is... It was the strongest member in, what was it, Super Mario World 2, or...?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I'm really trying to remember all of the trivia. But the point is, what I'm trying to get at is, we're looking at maybe a nice, good old-fashioned boss match here. Which I never thought I would say with Toad, but here we are.
Big man, slapping meat!
Coming in is Toad from the Awoken, which, once again, not sure why either picking Wario in particular, but okay. And into the ring, Toad goes. Oh, and Yumi, he's starting things off. Nice tie up. Ooh, and a big power slam. Oh, really starting to grind the elbow into the head of Toad. All right, tying up. Oh, Toad with a nice elbow check. Oh, Wario's back up. Nice little defensive maneuver. Oh, Wario just popping Toad up into a giant swing. Wario really, and another giant swing. Oh, Wario came to show the crowd what he's got. And a third giant swing.
Yeah, Wario is, Wario's being kind of a badass right now.
Oh, Wario's back up, though. Toad really trying to take it to the big man. Oh, but Wario with another power slam. And another giant swing. Oh, shit, Daisy's in the corner.
Yeah. Listen, there's a lot of friends here. We're starting the new year off with friendship.
You know, now I think we can start together. But anyways, that doesn't matter. Wario with a running power slam. And a nice shoulder check. Just absolutely just manhandling Toad. But Toad trying to get some offense back in. Oh, and getting Wario into the walls of Jericho. Oh, but Wario able to break out of there. Oh, and some big headbutts onto Toad. Oh, and that one read right into the mushroom tip. Oh, and into the mushroom tip again. Starting to get really incensed. Oh, and just Wario just showing off for the crowd. They're absolutely loving it. Oh, small package. That's only good for a two count, though. Oh, Wario trying to go. Oh, but Toad with the reversal. Oh, Wario coming back into the ring now. Oh, Toad with the big boot. Oh, now trying to work Wario in the figure four. Oh, but Wario able to reverse out of there. Oh, but Toad starting to pick up a little bit more momentum. Now into the camel clutch. But Wario doing a good job off soldiering through. Ooh, and just putting some knots into the head and another giant swing. Oh, Wario's going up. Ooh, and a big boy senton.
Biggest of boys.
Back up again. Oh, but he whiffs that big boy senton. And now Toad's there to capitalize as Daisy watches on. Oh, but Wario will break out of there. Oh, crap. Hacking Toad in the forehead, who catches Wario in a DDT. Oh, but Wario's the first one back up. Ooh, and some big headbutts, too. Oh, picking Toad back up. Oh, and of course, botched Irish whip.
Yeah, but I mean, it wouldn't be that with a botched Irish whip.
But damn, even his botched Irish whips look like they do damage. And Toad able to kick out on the two count from the big boy splash. Oh, but Wario able to get the ropes. Oh, and into the bear hug. Toad having to grab the rope. Oops, break out of there. Oh, and Toad taking Wario back into the walls of Jericho. But Wario able to shake out of there. Oh, but another big headbutt up from Toad. Ooh, and into a lariato. Oh, but Wario not being phased. Ooh, and a nice chest bump. Oh, and again, just driving that head into Toad. Oh, what does Wario have planned? Oh, into a flying cross chop to the back of the head. Oh, just swinging those meaty haymakers. Oh, but Toad, oh, picking Wario up and dumping him. Oh, and right into the mushroom tip again. Wario, of course, Oris, giving the crowd a show, just stunting on the haters. Oh, and sending Toad into the turnbuckle again. Uh-oh, what does Wario have in mind? Oh, but Toad with the reversal. Oh, but Wario quick to recover. Oh, and Toad dropping Wario with the ba-bomb. Ooh, that is a near fall. Wario needs to be absolutely careful right now. Oh, but Wario getting caught with the lariat. Oh, into an elbow check. Toad with another lariat. And a running power slam from Toad. Oh, but Wario found his second wind. Oh, but he gets caught with a brain buster from Toad. Oh. Well, oh, Wario able to capitalize, getting Toad into the bear hug. And Toad taps out.
Oof.
Wow. An impressive showing from newly acquired member, Wario.
Yeah, like I said, Wario's got that big Chad energy. So, of course, you know, I mean, Toad held in for as long as possible.
Yeah, that he did.
All right, and of course, up next, our undercard championship.
Yep, the undercard championship where Albert Wesker is going to be taking on what I can best describe as a thing of nightmares, James Masterson.
No, it's a homunculus.
Okay, the assless wonder, James Masterson.
Yeah. I don't know what to expect out of James Masterson since I just kind of like went up to Cole Tregg and he was like, yeah, no, just whatever. No, that's fine. That's funny. So he kind of went with what was funniest instead of what made sense.
You know what? Bold strategy. Let's see how that plays out.
Yeah, bold strategy, Cotton. Let's see how this works out. I don't know what to expect out of James Masterson.
I don't know either, but that also means Albert Wesker's not going to know either.
Yeah.
So that unpredictability will be James Masterson's best strength right now.
Yeah, I mean, I guess, sorry, Albert Wesker, in advance.
You poor guy went from Eric Sparrow to James Masterson.
Yeah, I don't, yeah. Hmm.
All right, and starting things off, it is James Masterson. I like how this, the thing just says James. With stars on his nipples and once again, no ass. And going up against him is probably the closest approximation we have in this match to a normal design, Albert Wesker.
Yeah.
But can Albert Wesker carry that momentum through? Or will Gaze Masterson be too much? And they are off. Oh, Albert Wesker starting things off. Oh, and a nice belly to back from Gaze Masterson. Ooh, nice hip toss too, which surprising in how Gaze Masterson could do that without, you know, hips. But again, it's just that unpredictability. You always gotta keep him guessing. Oh, and a belly to belly. Oh, and another hipless toss. And now working the leg. All right, you know, we're starting to see something from Gaze Masterson.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a nice power slam. Oh, but Wesker's back in though. Oh, and now going after the knee of Albert Wesker again. Wesker's holding tough. Oh, and another thing, and Gaze Masterson's really trying to employ a little more kicks, which is good because James Masterson right now has a significant height advantage. He's gonna want to be able to use that to keep Albert Wesker or at bay and be able to reach for angles. Albert Wesker can calculate. Oh, but the reversal and Albert Wesker targeting the knee, but Gabe Bastion able to get out of there. Also nice knee checks from James Masterson. Oh, and into the rear naked choke. That's the thing though, that rear naked choke of James Masterson is dangerous because you don't just have to fight, you're gonna have to fight off two halves instead of one. Oh, and James Masterson dropping over Wesker with the brain buster. Now going after the knee. So, RB, given what we're seeing right now, who do you got?
I am going to say that, I guess we've seen Albert Wesker take on worse.
I mean, yeah. Ooh, and a nice snap suplex from Albert Wesker. But again, it's hard to say, A, because again, this is first, you know, James Masterson's first singles, match, but you know, so far our Gaines Madison's putting on quite the show. Uh-oh, what's Gaines Madison have in mind? Oh, and some knife edge chops to the dick. Oh, now tying up with Albert Wesker. Ooh, and some rolling elbows. Again, you know that, and with that lack of hip and just pelvic regions get it in the way, a Gaines Madison's able to get a way more orb of turning radius on that too.
Ooh, yeah, but also doesn't have a lot of hip rotation to land those pins.
That is true. Oh, and a nice belly to belly from Gaines Masterson. Oh, Wesker coming back in. Now trying to corner Gaines Masterson, landing the brain buster. Oh, going for the pin right away. That's another thing to be careful when pinning Gaines Masterson. You try and lift that and let egg up. I mean, you might end up rolling yourself off James Masterson. Oh, and a running neck breaker from Albert Wesker. Oh, and Albert Wesker with a rolling elbow of his own. Oh, and from downtown with the shotgun drop kill. Oh, and into a Kinshasa.
Oh, that's a close one.
That is a close one. Gaines Masterson just trying to survive. Oh, and into the pendulum nightmare. Oh, and already going for the pin. Oh, but that range from Gaines Masterson's legs, able to reach the rope. Oh, but gets hit with another pendulum nightmare. Middle of the ring. No, Gaines Masterson is still standing. Oh, Wesker's starting to get frustrated. You can see. Oh, but Gaines Masterson, you hate to see it. Tried to go for a rolling elbow, but gets caught in a botched Irish whip. Oh, but Gaines Masterson tried to recover with a belly to back. Big soccer kick to the back of Albert Wesker. Oh, into a side slam. Oh, but Albert Wesker with another pendulum nightmare. And just like that, Albert Wesker with another defense under his belt. You know, commiserations to James Masterson. James Masterson didn't put up a good fight, but Wesker, man.
Yeah, I mean, fucking Wesker.
Fucking Wesker.
Though, to be fair, him and Chris Redfield are tied for the best record.
That tale is old as time.
Exactly. All right. So, I let you indulge yourself again, so...
Right. You want to know a why, RB?
Why?
Because this is the third day on the third month of the year on a year that has not one, not two, but three twos in it. And if you add those three twos together, you get six. And when you divide that by two, what does that get you? That gets you three. So you know what? I felt that was a sign for the next installment, the Ernie Loves Puns Tournament Third Strike Trios Edition.
Okay.
That's right. That team's had their fun. It's the Trios' time to shine.
All right, I see. No problem with this.
And don't worry. There's gonna be more three puns coming along the way.
Sadly, I am putting the names in as we speak, and they only go by Mario Team.
Well, that's fine. Don't worry. I have the names right here, and don't worry. We will divulge as we go. You know, we've got some, you know, some older team school teams coming in, as well as you know, some new teams, as it were. Because again, it wouldn't be an Ernie Loves Puns tournament without new teams being formed for the sake of making a pun name.
Okay.
Oh boy, we've got two big bangers coming today. Wait, can you just check to make sure that that team has the right... You did pick the right I3 members there, right?
Hold on, let me just... Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Sadly, I'm also going to look later to set up the rest of the teams, and I have to check the Facebook thing for our group chat for you to...
If you want, I can. If you want, I can just forward it to you on in the PM, so it'll be easier.
No, I have it right here in front of me, so that's good. So I just need to set up the second one. Anyway, continue to talk.
Okay, so, you know, so again, like I said, we're going into this again. Fierce is first. You know, they came in, had an absolute banger of a match. But you know, truth be told, looking at this, you know. Landscape-wise, again, there's the big question of, well, who's going to be the next step up? Because, you know, there's potential teams that have not had that chance to go yet, but really yet to have, like, that big show going to really stamp their ticket. Mm. And you had, you know, other teams that are more well-established, but that were just short, fell so short, or beforehand, and then, you know, you also have plenty of members on the roster. Or who've been, you know, grinding it out, you know, are hoping, again, are trying to, you know, get that rub, get that at shine, you know. Probably hoping to get it into this is to see if they can start making some magic, you know. And, again, you know, this is going to be a hell of a time with a hell of a match with just some great trios action. And again, the Ernie Loves Punts tournament tournaments have done wonders for the tag team division. I'm curious to entertain aim this to see how this is going to go with the trios. Yes, mostly to carry on with the puns. Because the whole point, it's Ernie Loves fucking puns. So you're goddamn right, I got to do the third Ernie Loves Puns tournament on the third month of the year, on the third day, and make it a fucking trios tournament. Somewhere... I am sure Gabe Newell is about to send me some very angry fucking letters in my email.
Hey, I'm Gabe Newell. It's me, I'm Gabe Newell. Anyway, I'm glad y'all are liking the Steam Deck so far, but, you know, Ernie, I'm gonna fucking sue your ass because, I don't know the number, I don't like the number three. I fucking hate the number three, and why would you do this to me, Ernie? You're using Steam. I'm gonna set Eric's computer on fire because I just hate you that much right now. Come on, Ernie. Don't be a dick, Ernie. I'm just, you know, buying time
I like how it's your computer that's going to be set on fire and not mine. Oh, God.
Anyway, for the quote unquote leader of these teams, I'm just doing whoever has, like, my favorite theme.
That's fair.
Yeah.
But yeah, we're gonna be, you know, we're obviously gonna be seeing some familiar faces. Basically, we haven't seen in a bit, and obviously, like, the new faces, which, you know, it's gonna be curious to see where this little thought experiment is gonna go.
Okay, cool.
So have time stalling done?
Yeah, time stalling done. Now I just need to put the cryon in the right place.
Of course.
All right, cool. And we are ready to go. So I'm going to say entry finished.
Entry finished indeed.
And then we're going to cut to the ring. Okay, there we go. Good.
So starting things off, it is a blast from the past. Isabel.
I accidentally set it to one-on-one.
It's fine.
Oh, okay. Well, anyway, it seemed the working class versus Team Hollywood.
No, Planet Hollywood.
Oh, Team Planet Hollywood. Okay.
Yes, yeah, so obviously to explain the working class, you know, Mario, Bernadette, you know, and Isabel, your administrative enforcer. Fighting against the new team of Planet Hollywood, consisting of Johnny Cage, movie star, Sora, a space ace traveler who travel through space in Kingdom Hearts, who is affiliated with several IPs from the biggest entertainment juggernaut in the world, as well as Rosalina, a princess of the stars and space, and also whose own IP is being made into a movie soon. So, of course, Planet Hollywood.
Yeah, okay, fair enough.
And also, I think the restaurant itself, Elf, is already shut down, so we're not going to get into any legal trouble.
Woo!
Hooray!
Yeah!
Start these off. We got Sora and Isabel. Now, Sora has had plenty of experience with dogs trained in the art of combat, but usually he's more used to them being allies rather than adversaries. Well,
right.
Wait, no, never mind. Scratch that. Pizza. Point being, Isabel's really taking it to the young lad. Oh, nice kick from Isabel. Now Rosalina getting tagged in. Oh, but Rosalina showing off that galactic princess strength. Oh, it's a nice double knee drop. Going into this. Oh, Isabel really starting to target it, the shoulder of Rosalina. So, RB, who do you got in this?
I think I'm going to say Team Planet Hollywood. They've all made a great show. No, actually, I'm going to give it to the working class. You know, I mean, yep. Isabel and Mario are experienced champions. You know, the tag team belt, you've got the 3KB belt, you've got, you know, undercard belt champions, you've got tag team belt champions. They've been everywhere, man.
Not to mention trios champions, too.
Yes, that is true, yes.
Oh, nice snap hammer for Bernadette. And also Bernadette, who's, again, much like Chris Redfield, had a rough start in the year, but ended it last year strong. Oh, but now Rosalina tagging into Johnny Cage. But again, you know, they should not be resting on their laurels against these upcoming upstarts. You know, maybe the team of Planet Hollywood might seem like just more fresh face, but you know, they might come in more energized, more motivated and stuff.
Right.
Roberta tagging to Mario. Oh, and right into the mushrooms. Oh, nice swing from Johnny Cage. You know, the character being voiced by Chris Pratt, fighting against that's the character who, if his previous movie didn't suck, would have most likely been played by Chris Pratt. Which I don't want, because it should always be The Miz.
Yeah, that's, oh my god. No, that was going to be so close. Yes.
I still maintain, hey, there's only two roles. There's like two specific roles that The Miz is the only one qualified for the job, and that is as a live action Johnny Cage and a live action Travis Touchdown.
I could see that, yeah.
But Isabel and Rosalina squaring up, which actually there's a good question. In the event that the Mario movie does well enough that they end up going into a sequel and eventually Rosalina makes it on there, who do you think they're gonna get for Rosalina?
Who I think it should be somebody like with a gorgeous voice that's ethereal. Like, I see like Janelle Monáe would probably be my pick for Rosalina, but they're just gonna Google like any chick who's famous at the time and be like, yep, she's doing it.
Fair. I was gonna go with Ray Romano.
Yeah, Ray Romano.
Oh, and now Sora getting in his shoulder work as Bernadette goes for the pin. Oh, but Sora kicks out at one. Oh, Bernadette they're getting dragged left into the center of the ring. Sora trying to pick things up. Now, while Bernadette has been improving, especially in, on her technical side, Sora's just been just an absolute just speedball, high flyer, just agility. Oh, but he gets caught with a gut-wrench suplex. Also, not to mention the fact that Sora can, in fact, breathe fire as well. He hasn't done it recently. Chances are he's probably low on MP. Oh, but a nice swinging neckbreaker from Sora. And now tagging to Johnny Kage. Oh, nice. Nice grab from Sora. Oh, Sora able to save a Planet Hollywood the teammate as they start going to work on Bernadette. Oh, nice swing. A nice roundhouse from Johnny. And now tagging into Mario. Oh, now tying up. Mario catching Johnny Cage into a Goomba Stomp. Ooh, and just swinging the big, big fist. Oh, nice. Ice standing splash. Oh, but now the two of them are going at it. Oh, Johnny Cage getting the better of this. Ooh, big uppercut into El Magistral. Oh, and there was the working class, right? Hey, to break it up. Now Isabel trying to soften Johnny Cage. Hey, jump, but Johnny Cage breaks free. Ooh, and Mario with the big slap to the face. Now back in as Isabel and Rosalina get tagged in. Oh, but a nice reversal from Rosalina. As Johnny Cage pieces up Mario. Mario's no man's land. Oh, but Isabel with the reversal. Oh, but Rosalina reversing with an arm drag. Oh, but Isabel L responding with a swinging neck breaker. Oh, but Rosalina responding by reversing. Oh, but Isabel really working the shoulder on Rosalina right now. Oh, and Isabel with another arm drag. Oh, and into a dragon screw. Isabel's starting to fire on all cylinders right now. Oh, but into the corner Rosalina goes. As Isabel just slapping the shit out of Rosalina. Oh, but Rosalina able to dodge out of the way. Now Sora and Bernadette both getting tagged in. Some big boots from Rosalina. Oh, and into a backward stunner from Rosalina. Oh, but Bernadette responding with a brainbuster. And into, ooh, a double underhook suplex. Oh, but there's Planet Hollywood to bring it up. It is just pandemonium right now. Oh, but Sora able to catch Bernadette with a Hurricane Rana. And a flipping dropkick. Now, RB, kind of going into this, you know, you're looking at, I mentioned before how, especially with the tag team composition, is so important. And as is the composition in trios. So, depending with how the working class and, you know, Planet Hollywood are looking, who do you think's got a better or comp strategy-wise right now?
I'd honestly say that, I mean, the working class do have a very balanced, roster right now because of grit. I think a lot of what Planet Hollywood offers is flash. You know, you got Johnny Cage obviously jumping and doing splits. You've got Sora, who's like, I'm going to tell my story over 90 fucking games. And you've got Princess Rosalina, who hasn't been giving us that much of a showing right now.
That is true. And again, kind of going back to that, because usually, you know, you're looking at a comp like, with trios comp right now, it's usually, you tend to have a lot of them kind of go all in and min-max into kind of one stat. So you kind of see that with working class, but they're comping that of grit because there's no way anybody can question the grit of Bernadette, of the mechanic Bernadette, Mario, or even Isabel. Again, like you said, Planet Hollywood, again, like you said, it's a lot of it is kind of very much leading in with Flair, what with, you know, Johnny Cage's movies darness and Sora's more acrobatics stylings and stuff. But then you have Rosalina, who is capable of doing, you know, showing some flash, but she's definitely seems to be more playing more the tank here, you know, playing more of a powerhouse role, which makes sense because she is is she is tall because she is a very tall and strong woman. Which, you know, to be fair, spending time in, you know, zero gravity and with planets of varying in gravitational forces will probably beef you up a bit.
Yeah.
Mario with the belly to belly onto Sora. Oh, now backing out, tagging it into Isabelle. And recall, Mario was actually the one who beat Sora for his undercard art belt so many months ago. Oh, and now Sora retreating back into Johnny Cage. Into a double Brain Buster to the outside of the ring. And Johnny Cage with the Rider Kick from the top rope. Again, that Planet Hollywood Flash, those high risk maneuvers. It'll get the crowd pumped, but you gotta be careful because at the end of the day, your goal here is to win. Ooh, and that one went right into the bell bag. Going back and forth. Johnny Cage with the super kick. Picking up Isabelle back up. And another roundhouse. Oh, but Isabelle with the drop toe hold. And Isabelle getting in touch with her wild side. Oh, and now going into the knee bar onto Johnny Cage. And now both teams trying to stop this. All into an assisted German onto Rosalina as Bernadette hits Sora with the swinging neck breaker. Ooh, but what a kick combo! Oh, from Johnny Cage tagging into Rosalina as Bernadette gets tagged in. Oh, and Rosalina getting caught with a dragon screw. And now really working, Isabelle really working the leg of Rosalina. Okay, now focusing back onto the competitors and a big boot from Rosalina. Oh, what does Rosalina have in mind? And another backward stunner. Oh, but Bernadette not phased, but gets caught in an arm drag. Oh, but competitors are back up. Tagging into Johnny Cage. Well, as Bernadette trying to choke out Rosalina, Johnny Cage going up into a single knee drop. Picking Bernadette back up. Oh, and into an arm drag from Johnny Cage. Oh, Johnny Cage able to dodge out of the way from that dropkick from Bernadette, who's been taking a lot of punishment tonight. Oh, into a big flying knee from Johnny. Goes in for the pin.
Nope.
Planet Hollywood with a successful body blocking, but Bernadette's still able to kick out. Oh, Bernadette gets caught with that axe kick. And how having to tag into Isabelle. Now notice Mario's not been tagged in yet. Trying to get at a little bit of energy back as Isabelle getting hit into the bell bag again. Ooh, and into a coup de grace. Oh, but Isabelle's back up. Into a singing neck breaker. Isabelle's going up. Into the big dog senton. Oh, but Johnny kicking out at two. Johnny was in a precarious situation and stuck in the working class's corner. Oh, and Johnny Cage taps out. And the first winners of the Ernie Loves Puns 3 Trios Tournament Edition is the Working Class. And it is a 5-star match.
Hell, yes.
What'd I tell you? These monthly gimmicks are fucking gold.
Yeah.
All right. Now so, I believe...
Yeah, no, what were you going to say?
It wasn't going to be important.
Okay. Well, I mean, it is about time for the break, so we're going to be right back. Or we're going to take our pee breaks, we're going to get some coffee. We're going to have a good time.
Yeah.
So, welcome to Hardcore Nerdcore. I am Rhythm Bastard. I go to break. I love you. This is the break. I love you. The end. No, what is the Mr. Frog show? I don't know. I fucking love Smiling Friends, but it's just like went in one ear, out the other. Anyway, here's some MC Lars.
Yeah.
By the way, I think we need to do like the most violent thing for the last match.
I'm listening.
I don't know. I mean, I'm just trying to think. Like, yeah. like for Thrash, for, I don't know what the most one is, but you tell me, because you're the one like watching. So.
Okay. Don't worry. I'll think of something. I'll think of something.
Okay. Yeah.
I thank Sean for an industry that he blessed, because Napster was our generation's Gutenberg crest. They say Fanning flipped the domino that toppled the tower. Peer-to-peer file sharing had a lot of power in the way he decentralized music distribution. Satoshi looked at finance, had a similar solution. But where will we be in 2023? Counting confirmations, rising seas are all I see. Can we fix our mistakes if we switch to proof of stake? If I'm it, an NFT, will global warming escalate? As I'm sitting in my script for watching California fires, is this ledger that I'm holding sending carbon levels higher? Mendocino's burning, and they blamed it on the blockchain. Counting confirmations, watching Cali going up in flames. Mendocino's burning, and they blamed it on the blockchain. Counting confirmations, watching Cali going up in flames.
You know our math is brilliant, cause you can't understand it. Got you thinking that our Ponzi scheme will benefit the planet as our value gets remanded to the custody of orbit. Every speculator took a look and they adored it. You could floor it. But one person's gas burning anyway. Drop inside the bucket. Soar before we plummet. The land and see we stuck it. Bounce like a springboard. Could go forever, don't you think? And you could bring more friends with you next time. Or if you run out, try some internet strangers. Fill them with doubt. How all the criticisms they've been hearing are the first clue that someone's keeping secret. How all that stuff is reverse true. Fact, we're good for the climate. We're just helping. Probably cure poverty on accident or something. It doesn't matter if our interests seem opaque. Set it all on fire. Anything less is a mistake.
Mendocino's burning, and they blamed it on the blockchain. Counting confirmations, watching Cali going up in flames. Mendocino's burning, and they blamed it on the blockchain. Counting confirmations, watching Cali going up in flames.
Adam Smith said that man is an animal that bargains, a captain of industry who saw a global market.
Look,
well, maybe crypto could incentivize green energy. Excess wind and solar could be utilized potentially.
Yeah, right. Electricity no one's using. We'll use that. We'll leverage the potential energy of swelled heads in loose hats. We'll tell feds they can move fast or get left behind with their feet. VI when we move past.
And wait, hold up. Do you hear that sound? A deflationary asset might cut consumption down.
Deflation's fantastic. It's like free interest on our hoards. And the best part is you can't participate if you're poor.
But the corporate elite likes how everything is now. Mainstream media is dying. Too like the blockchain somehow.
There's no shortage of villains in our current dystopia. But fire season's open and you're coping. So here's hoping, y'all.
Mendocino's burning. Mendocino's burning. Mendocino's burning and they blamed it on the blockchain. Counting confirmations. Counting confirmations. Counting confirmations. Watching Cali going up in flames. Mendocino's burning. Mendocino's burning. Mendocino's burning and they blamed it on the blockchain. Counting confirmations. Counting confirmations. Counting confirmations. Watching Cali going up in flames.
The rise of credit evidently not an accident. Well, Mother Nature needed the champion of environment. If she was my daughter, there's no way I could be prouder. Went to battle against power and then won every encounter. And she's representing for the future we need. Where we're doing things for others instead of doing for greed. All it takes to make a difference is be willing to join. That's the point.
And I'm sorry, this is supposed to be about Bitcoin?
On the hunt and it won't be long, so say your prayers cause you're locked in his sights, casting shadows through your windows every night, every night. One look in his eyes and you're sure to go insane. Still worshiping the darkest Arctic caves to this day. 300 feet tall, giant wings spread smiling, part dragon, part demon, dividing and defiling.
The reaper meets Cthulhu, what you gonna do when they come through, releasing all the demons and cursing you like it's voodoo. Come wicked like I'm Hulu, they watch it poke like I'm Hulu. Evil spirits in their brain, they got them all going cuckoo. We the great old ones, MC Larson, Project Born. No escaping from Cthulhu, pay attention, you've been warned. Like a catastrophic storm, causing damage to your dome. Here's a message to your family, you ain't never coming home. Now you're
calling on the phone, calling on the phone. And now you'll never be alone, never be alone. And now he's all up in your dome, all up in your dome.
All right, I actually was, did kind of get lost in... Part of that break took longer than I thought because I'm kind of digging MC Lars. You know, I was like, oh, you know, I fell off MC Lars, but I was like, oh yeah, he like makes good stuff. So anyway, hello, I'm Mr. Frog. Welcome to the show. I eat the bug. Om nom nom. I ate the bug. It's the end of the show. I love you. Anyway, I love you because I'm Rhythm Bastard. You can join us and support us by donating to my Patreon. That's right, patreon.com/rhythmbastard. For $1 a month, you get every MP3 I download it. I'm sorry, it's been a while. You get every song I release in a downloadable format of your choosing, and you get to suggest a wrestler for HCNCW over here. So of all the various bullshit I've been a part of, you can pick one, you can make one. For $5, you get all the stems to every song I make, and you get to make a wrestler here. So we work with you to do the whole, you know, we give you an entrance theme, a whole gimmick and everything. So yeah, you can, hopefully you don't do what Coltrug did and just do whatever. Also, and for $20 a month, you get to hang out with me. We do a little VIP show after every show I do, and you get to, book a belt. We have a broski belt that's specifically meant for people at this level. So that's going to be something really cool that you get to do. Also, I have, I am going to have some music soon at Patreon. That's patreon.com/rhythmbastard. Again, Bandcamp Friday is tomorrow. So you can help me out by going to, rhythmbastard.bandcamp.com, pick up some music. I also got some merch, got a bunch of cool shit for you. And the Bastard Thon is coming soon. I need to draft up an email to send out to all the participants. Ernie, my co-commentator, is going to be participating in that. And basically, it's like the closest thing I have to making a convention where I just have, you know, I just hang out with all my cool friends and we do a bunch of cool shit. So that's going to be fun. And it's also a way to earn money, as you can see down here at the bottom and through all the screens. There is a goal that we're working toward. Currently, that goal is at $5,000 to fund my album, Hardcore Nerdcore Punk Rock. We've got a bunch of great merch for you. A lot of great people have worked on it. And there's just, I'm feeling better about things.
That's good. I'm glad.
Yeah, that's all I can say right now. I mean, you know, shit's in these weird transitionary period, but at least I have a handle on things. I got a whole notepad of shit that I'm going to get on after this, but I'm probably just going to shave my thrash panda fursuit. Yes, I do have a... Actually, hold on. I'll show that to you guys right now. Ernie, I don't know if you're watching the stream, but yeah.
I am.
I just realized that thing sheds like a motherfucker. So, I don't know what my stream plans are, but I know that I might be comfortable playing Danganronpa 3 again. I do know I want to finish that. But yeah, and now we're going to go back to the Ernie show. The Eric and Ernie show. I'm sorry. The Eric, yeah. Ernie and Logo show.
Yeah.
All right. So... Now, what do we have next?
All right, so there's going to be a little backstory with this. So after Self-Aggrandizement Death Match, I was you know, getting changed out of the locker room and, you know, trying to head back. We were all heading back to our cars to, you know, go about our week. I noticed a very familiar and characteristic shrill screaming, you know, deep within the stadium. So... doing my due diligence as a commentator and a journalist here in wrestling, I followed the lead. Turns out Tails isn't exactly happy with how the self-aggrandizement sadness aggravation death match turned out. Complimentary of obviously of Sonic and Luigi for their big wins, but really laid into the rest of the team, and strangely enough, Jonesy in particular. It was hard to pick things up because, you know, there comes a point where the shrill screaming becomes unintelligible. But from what I've picked up, Tails has given Jonesy a mission to cement his loyalty. And with that, Jonesy is, which takes us to tonight's match, as Jonesy takes on the Scout.
Okay.
Again, what this so-called mission was, I have no idea. Again, what that mission is, I have no idea. I was only able to pick up so much, but it looks like Jonesy's coming in here on assignment for the Awoken.
Against
a former pupil.
Yeah, I mean, granted, Saxon Hale can only teach the mercenaries so much about the fine art grapple sportsmanship. So, you know, it only stands to reason that, that Jonesy would try this. So, who knows? I mean, at the very least, chances are it's going to be good for RED as well to kind of see where, you know, if they make another, if they make another run at the, you know, want to make another run at
Correct.
Things. Yeah. So.
Correct. Sorry, go ahead.
No, I was going to let you speak.
Well, what I was going to say was I will keep my ears to the ground and I'll keep trying to come back each week with whatever more info I can find about this. But yeah, as of right now, all we know is that Jonesy and the Scout are about to fight.
All right. And you know what we do before we go to the fight? Oh, we cut it to the ring.
And coming in first, Jonesy Spencerson tied for the most five-star matches last year.
Yeah.
He's also the one with the worst structure of the three, but, you know, let's not split hairs here. And, you know, in spite of this recent, you know, turn and stuff, he's coming in as a formidable opponent, especially against the Scout, you know, a former pupil, someone who he helped train. So, and of course, a lot of the REP team have picked up a lot from Saxon Hale, but Jonesy was really the one that hiding those bolts into adapting that sort of wrestling wild animal style into being applicable to humans. Oh, Jonesy already going for the single leg. Oh, Scout's going in first. Now, again, an RED member against Jonesy Spencer, this is going to be building to be real, real blood feud. Oh, it's a nice nightmare, which we got a glimpse of that when the Spy and Jonesy squared up during the self-aggrandizing death match. As Scout begins to try and grind the elbow into Jonesy's face, but Jonesy, he's still walking Scout down. Oh, into a single leg. Bang Scout to the center of the ring. Oh, and already off the bat into the surfing board. Oh, but Scout able to get out of there. Oh, but a big poke to the eyes. Into a drop toe hold from Jonesy. Oh, and into a weave snatcher. Again, Jonesy coming in proper form. Oh, but Scout with the poke to the eyes. Yeah, I feel like we're going to be seeing a lot more dirty fighting than usual coming from Scout. Oh, but Scout getting caught with a Fujiwara armbar. But I mean, yeah, so RB, I mean, what do you think? I mean, how do you think RED and even the rest of the old Gymposium is still going, essentially, you know?
Betrayed.
Coach and mentorless.
You know, I guess they're probably feeling very betrayed right now, but you can't, really, I guess, dwell on that too much when it's clear that there are, you know, bigger things to worry about.
Of course.
Yeah.
And Jonesy really trying to take it to the Scout from an octopus hold to a backbreaker. Oh, but Scout with a running bulldog. Oh, already going for the pin right away. Oh, but Jonesy able to kick out of there. Oh, and Scout targeting the knee. 5 minutes have apparently gone.
Well, I mean, yeah, because that's, I mean, I believe the lady.
Yeah, that's fair. Oh, but Jonesy's still just circling around the Scout. Oh, but the Scout with a snap suplex. Oh, and Jonesy sending Scout to the outside. And brainbusters the Scout back into the ring. Oh, and hits Scout with an Elizabeth Berkeley. Oh, into a water wheel drop. Into a sidewalk slam. Into the backslide. Ooh, that is a near fall. The Scout's gonna have to be careful. Oh, nice reversal from Jonesy. Oh, but the Scout's still hanging tough. Oh, Jonesy with a drop toe into the ropes. Now, folks out there in the audience, you gotta be careful with those ropes. Those are not soft ropes. And with the bridging German suplex, Jonesy makes quick work of the Scout.
You live by the fast, you die by the fast, I guess.
Yeah. Well, to be fair, the Scout out isn't somebody who has a lot of health, so he's very squishy and very easy to, you know,
yes,
once you catch him.
I believe a glass cannon is the scientific term.
That is true.
Now, I'm looking at the next match on the card, and I don't know why I'd ever assume you'd stop loving puns, because this one is also, well, no, it's not a pun, so this one's just, no, it's just, hold on.
It's a tag team match.
Yeah, it's just a regular old tag team match that cannot fit on the Cryon.
I mean, if you want, you could just put the names.
Well, I don't know. I think that would be just as long and also kind of dumb.
Here, tell you what, just make the Cryon as big as possible and just overlay it over the actual match.
I don't want to anymore. I don't know.
All right, fine. I'm sorry. I can't help it. These two teams, you know, they haven't been booked yet. We kind of need to get a good eye on what our tag team scene is looking like. One of these teams we haven't seen in grapple in a bit. What? Just fucking why not? It's fine.
Okay, I guess. But only if we put Mr. Bidoof.
Of course. Yeah. Which, so I'm glad to see Mr. Bidoof coming back for you to the hardcore wrestling. And opening things up is the team of Derek Maslow, winner of the Derek Maslow Award of the Grapplies from the Earningverse, and male Wii Fit trainer, the Health and Well-Beings. Another favorite, a team made up of fan favorites, really trying to make their way up the ranks in the tag team, but as they're going up against RPG's Pals Club tag team we haven't seen in a bit, the RPG Pals Club, Bring Your Kid to Wrestle Day.
Yeah.
You know, with the Dandy Warforge of Kier and Kier's surrogate and child, Raymond. Let's start things off as Kier and Male Wii Fit Trainer. Oh, nice drop to hold from Kier. Oh, but Male Wii Fit Trainer really starting to target the joints. Again, Male Wii Fit Trainer, they're still in proper form. Thing with, you know, coming in with the health and well beings, you know, it's a tried and true method of going all in on tactical abilities, as well as using their knowledge of medicine, anatomy, physiology to really put the proper pain onto their opponents. How that translates to a Warforged, I don't know, but there's only one way to find out. And then here tagging into Raymond, which also I don't know how Maslow and Male Wii Fit Trainer's knowledge of human anatomy and physiology is going to help when fighting a beholder.
Yeah. I mean, here's the thing, it's a baby beholder.
Yeah. But at the same time, it's a baby beholder.
Yeah. But it's a baby.
But still a beholder, RP, like am I just gonna grab like a little tadpole and say like, yeah, no, I know. No, I know everything about this thing because I know, the human anatomical model.
Right. Well, I mean, it's you know.
Here's getting tagged in. As Male Wii Fit Trainer started to take it to Kier. Oh, God, I just realized there's a lot of grace in this matchup with just the accent of, with just the Derek Maslow accent, wrestler.
Yeah.
Oh, Male Wii Fit Trainer's still hanging tough. Now, between the two teams, who do you think's got this one?
I think Derek Maslow and the Male Wii Fit Trainer, they have, I mean, granted, you know, Kier is a champion, but he is a champion that didn't last terribly long.
Right, but again, you also need to look. Let's not discount Kier's record. You know, we're looking at the same person that was able to finally usurp Would You Rather Body.
That's true. Yeah.
Whereas Derek Maslow, again, perpetual bridesmaid, never the bride. Mm-hmm. Oh, and a nice maneuver from Raymond Brandywine. But again, also, Bring Your Child to Wrestle Day will have the physical disadvantage considering Raymond is still a child.
Yeah.
But he is a child that has shown to have great skills as he's getting caught in the chicken wing by the Male Wii Fit Trainer. Oh, nice snap suplex from Raymond. And the thing is, and into a nice cutter from Raymond. Uh-oh. Into the sweet chin music! Oh, and now tagging it into Derek Maslow. Raymond going up. Into a 450. Oh, now Derek Maslow's starting to square up. Now the young upstart starting to really show some promise. Oh, but now Derek Maslow is just taking it to the baby beholder. Oh, is Raymond able to fight out of it though? Oh, now they're going back and forth. And Raymond with a nice hit, tagging it to Kier. Trying to soften Derek Maslow up. Kier tying up. Nice double drop kick onto Derek Maslow. Really trying to work the legs right now. Oh, and Derek Maslow with the fireman's carry. Into a drop kick. Oh, but Kier's back up. Oh, and dropping Derek Maslow with the brainbuster. And tagging into Raymond. Oh, is Derek Maslow still targeting Kier? Kier catching Derek Maslow in his own game. Really trying to work the arm and soften him up. Oh, but here comes Male Wii Fit Trainer. Oh, and Raymond and able to catch Male Wii Fit Trainer with that enziguri. Oh, and Derek Maslow with the miscalculation. Able to jump over Raymond, but that gets Raymond to hit the Male Wii Fit Trainer. Oh, but the Male Wii Fit Trainer is starting to recuperate. Oh, but Raymond with the reversal. Raymond really showing on some grit. Oh, but a Northern Lights into an armbar. Kier has to come in to break up the count. Oh, nice reversal. Oh, Male Wii Fit Trainer reversing out of it. Seem like Raymond and Kier are about to get something going. Oh, what a flip from the Male Wii Fit Trainer. Into the walls of Jericho from Derek Maslow. Oh, but Kier coming in with the surfboard.
You know what? Kier is an exacting opponent, if nothing else.
But Derek Maslow responding with an exploder suplex on top of Raymond. Oh, but unable to get the pin on the Northern Lights. Oh, and there comes Umza. That's only good for a near fall. Jeez, the action is catching up to a path of every time keeping up. Oh, nice reversal from Kier. Picking up Derek Maslow. Nice reversal from Kier. Oh, but Derek Maslow with the reversal. And, of course, Rosh Irish Whip.
Yeah, I mean, it wouldn't be with the Bot Irish Whip.
Ken, you really need to start considering adding Botched Irish Whips to the merch. Oh, and what a powerbomb into a jackknife from the Male Wii Fit Trainer. Oh, but Kier able to kick out. Oh, and into an airplane suplex. But Kier, again, able to get a foot on the rope. Oh, and another whirlwind suplex. I'm still working on trying to figure out the names.
That's well, fair.
Still nothing yet. I will come back to that in a bit.
Fair enough.
Oh, tagging into Raymond. Into the drop. Hop kick. Oh, and with the roll up.
Whoop.
I think Kier might have gotten a little glitch in the matrix, but Raymond able to successfully kick out of there. On Raymond reversing the Northern Lights into a DDT. Oh, and Raymond getting cracked in the back of the head. Oh, Raymond back up. Oh, but getting caught with a gut wrench. Up comes Derek Maslow. He's starting to take it to the young lad. Went to a nice shoulder check. Raymond back up. Oh, Raymond with the drop toe hold though. Oh, but Derek Maslow reversing into a released German suplex. Oh, but Raymond's back up. Raymond retreating, tagging it to Kier. And a double enziguri. Oh, Derek Maslow is seeing stars right now.
Oh, God. And not just the ones in Hollywood.
Nope. And a big splash from Kier. Oh, holding Derek Maslow down. Nice drop kick, double team maneuver. Catching Derek Maslow in the arm bar. And Derek Maslow taps. Bring your child to Wrestle Day with a big showing tonight.
Oof.
Ooh, so close.
Yeah.
So close.
So close, yet but, so far.
You know, it's a little ring. Maybe there's a little bit of ring rust, but again, fantastic showing from Bring Your Child Out to Wrestle Day. Here, showing hasn't slowed down, and Raven really, really started to impress S.
Yeah, who knows the little beholder buddy could do it. And, I mean, they took down the two of the most, like, solid wrestlers in the company. So, you know what? Good on you, folks.
Good on you.
Good on you.
Love to see it.
Good on you, mateys. All right. And up next, we continue the Ernie Loves Puns tournament.
Rios edition.
Yes.
With two new teams. Are you ready to go? Because I'm excited.
Go ahead.
Let it ride. All right, RB. Let it ride.
All right. I was going to say, you want to explain the pun name? Or I guess you're going to introduce them. But they're going to be introduced one at a time, so.
Kill yourself first.
Oh, okay, fine. All right. Let me just... Reveal yourself!
So starting things off, we've got, from the Taste of Dragons, Todd. Now, there's some potential we can go here, you know. Could be a meeting of Burninators. Possibly a surprise with a new member with three tons of fun. Because joint pointing Todd is fellow tag team member of Indie Love, Officer Dooley from the Dark Side Detective.
Wow.
So, a mascot for podcast dedicated to indie gaming, and a character from an indie video game. Who's going to make the anchor? None other than known independent filmmaker Neil Breen. Ladies and gentlemen, your next trios... The Indie Darlings.
The Indie Darlings. The Indie Love Coalition, if you are a fan of...
And going up against them is Miss Bayonetta. Now, I did say these were the new team, so this isn't a return of a new edition of the Future Femme Fatales. But who is going to be joining her is the question. Well, we got the cleric of the RPG Pals Club, Dodger.
You know, I'm glad to see Dodger get more play.
Yeah, and who's going to be joining both Bayonetta and Dodger to tie this team together? And so I can finally reveal what the fucking pun is? None other. The Holy Trinity.
Okay, fair. Fine.
Oh, we're starting things off with Robert Prophets and Neil Breen. Let's see how the Preacher Man and the High Flying King, is that going to be able to confound Neil Breen, or is Neil Breen going to be able to soldier through? Now, looking at this, once again, let's talk team comps here, RB.
Okay.
So you're coming in here with the team of the Indie Darlings, which, to be fair, they're coming into this tournament definitely as the underdog. But remember what I said with a lot, you see a lot of, like, these trios comps being those made up of just focusing, going min-maxing on one either concrete or sort of ambiguous skill set. Well, with the Indie Darlings, they are coming in with the most heart. Because, you know, you've got lovable underdogs in both Todd and Taste of Dragons. And because, actually, to this, that is the nature of being an Indie Darling. You are a perpetual underdog who just wants that moment and wants that drive to be able to finally get at those eyes on you. While the big Ignames are too scared to let you shine. But how is that going to stack up against the top of Holy Trinity, where you've got, the high-flying acrobatics of a Robert Prophet. You know, a little more or of a strength from Bayonetta, who's also not afraid to go up high. You know, very well-rounded person, as well as the cleric Dodger Kelly, someone who's good at being able to take a punishment, keep a team going, really hold it together. You know, I mean, who do you got at RB?
You know, I think I am going with the Holy Trinity because they are a group that is ready to prepare themselves. They are, you know what I mean? They're ready to prepare themselves. They need to prove themselves, and they have the power of God and or anime on their side.
Well, considering that a creation of Kamiya, of Hideki Kamiya is there, chances are there is definitely anime on that side. Also, wait, is it pronounced Kamiya or Kamiya?
I don't know. I've heard it both ways.
Hang on. I need to look this up.
And if, you know, and I mean, if, and if you were to ask him, he'd probably block you.
Yeah, probably. Oh, and a nice running bulldog from Dodger Kelly onto Neo Green. I don't know, RB. I think I might have to go with the Indie Darlings, mostly because who doesn't love a good underdog story? Now Neo Breen tying up with the Peach Special, but Dodger Kelly able to fight out of there. Oh, nice elbow drop. And now tagging in into Miss Bayonetta. Oh, and a nice belly to back act from top. Odd. Sending Bayonetta into the ropes. Oh, nice arm drag from Todd. Oh, Todd dodging out of the way. Now, Todd also is coming in. You know, you're also seeing teams that are coming in here that, whilst they're new teams, you have people that are, you know, familiar with the concept of being inside of a trio. So obviously, Todd Taste of Dragons, being a member of not only the Burninators but also of Three Tons of Fun, Bayonetta with her time with the future, her Femme Fatales. Oh, Dr. Kelly, whilst not ever really being in a trios per se, has experience, you know, teaming up with the RPG Pals Club. And in that same breath, Dooley, not a lot of experience as a trio competitor, but has that experience in team wrestling, you know, with the likes of Turf Ferguson and Rent-A-Tag. Again, Hot Toys of Drag, and what a Hurricane Rana for Robert Prophet. And again, with Ms. Bayonetta, not, she also has that tag team experience with Chris Redfield, old as part of the Redgrave Ape Conspiracy. Oh, now tagging into Neo Breen. And then you've got the likes of Robert Preacher Man and Robert Prophet and Neo Breen. Both wild cards, both not really known to have had a long time in like a team setting, but you know, let's not discount the fact, you know, Robert Prophet's time with, you know, the short-lived team of Leap of Faith, as well as Neo Breen's time with the Altor Assassins.
Right.
Oh, Neo Breen tying up, really taking it to Bayonetta, Dr. Kelly to the outside, Todd joining in as Julian and Robert Prophet are going at it. Oh, and Robert Prophet just knee off on him. Oh, Neo Breen better getting it in. Ooh, just barely missing the count. Oh, and Todd with the big elbow drop out to Dodger. All right, Neo Breen tagging into Dooley. Ooh, that might be a bit of a dangerous strategy to go with, as Dooley got beefed up upgrades by Robert Prophet. He's still recovering. And what a power slam on Bayonetta. With a single knee drop. Trying to go into the pin. Oh, but Dodger's there. Air to make the break. Oh, it's a nice snapmare for a Monster Dooley. And a double brain buster, sending Bayonetta to the outside of the ring. Oh, and Robert Prophet slides on home into Officer Dooley's face. Oh, into standing moonsault from Bayonetta. Ooh, that is a near fall. Oh, it is just pandemonium as Miss Bayonetta is still to the outside of the ring. Oh, and Officer Dooley finally tagging into Tate's Dragon as Robert Prophet gets tagged in. Oh, Bayonetta still piecing up Officer Dooley. Oh, Robert Prophet's going for a pin, but Todd still hanging tough. Going to a swinging backbreaker. Oh, and a swanton bomb from Robert Prophet. Oh, but Todd able to wake up. Todd going up into the big splash. Oh, nice reversal from Robert Prophet. Oh, Robert Prophet's being shoulder checked by Todd. Oh, but there's the Oathbreaker from Robert Prophet. And going for the pin right away. Oh, but Todd able to get at a hand on the ropes. And another Oathbreaker from Robert Prophet. Oh, into a Poison Rana. Trying to go for the pin again, but Todd's still able to get the rope. Oh, now finally tagging into Dr. Kelly as Dooley gets hit with the double Enziguri. Todd retreating back into Neil Breen, who gets caught with the Kelly Cutter. Oh, but Dr. Kelly getting caught out with a running bulldog. Oh, is Neil Breen picking up Dodger. Oh, but Dr. dodging out of the way of the dropkick. And another dropkick from Neil Breen. Oh, but Neil Breen getting caught out by Dodger. Oh, and Dodger with the small package. Ooh, that is a near fall. You know, the Holy Trinity is doing a fantastic job picking their spots right now, RB.
Yeah, it's definitely getting they're definitely getting in a lot of good hits right now. And I think for people who we haven't really seen well represented, they're just doing great. They're keeping their own. And I think, you know, we're going to see a lot of great stuff from them.
Oh, and Todd getting dropped by the Witch Time. Oh, and Neil Breen tagging into Officer Dooley. Dr. Kelly gets hit with the DDT. How can Dooley capitalize with a belly to back? Is Dodger going to be able to tough it out? Oh, Dodger roll up, but Dooley able to kick out. And a double brainbuster to the outside of the ring. And now here comes the rest of the teams. Dodger fighting for his life on the outside. As the rest of the Holy Trinity is taking it to Dooley, trying to soften Dooley up. Oh, Dodger making it back inside. Oh, but Dooley responding with a snapmare to a single knee drop. Picking up Dr. Kelly. But Dr. Kelly retreating into Bayonetta. And Dr. Dooley retreating into Neil Breen. Neil Breen saving Officer Dooley from Dodger. Oh, but Dodger with the Russian leg sweep. Oh, but now out Bayonetta back up as Neil Breen is in no man's land and dropped with the vertebraker. Oh, but there's Todd to make the save. Oh, and what a double brainbuster from the Holy Trinity. Oh, and a big dropkick from Bayonetta. Oh, Neil Breen trying to tag in, but Bayonetta catching him. Oh, into a mule kick. Is Bayonetta going to try and put this away now? Oh, but Neil Breen with the backslide. Oh, but the Holy Trinity is there to break it up. This is a fantastic match.
Yeah, no, there's been a lot of back and forth. I'm super hyped.
And again, this is coming from a lot of characters we haven't seen in a bit. And Bayonetta with the roll up. And the Holy Trinity takes it. Wow. What a showing. And it is a 5-star match.
Yeah, I mean, what else could there have been?
So, coming into the that side of the bracket has been is finished. So come the semis, we can't randomize the semis, can we?
No, we can't. I mean, like, I can start over again. Because we know, like, us on the other end know who won. But,
We'll think about it. We will think about it.
Yeah,
The point is, going forward, our first two winners in the Ernie Loves Puns Tournament Third Strike Edition Trios is the working class of Mario, Bernadette, and Isabel. Oh, strong showing from a stable we haven't seen in a bit. Hoping to probably get some big things going this year. And the and an exciting new team in the Holy Trinity, consisting of Robert Prophets, Dodger Kelly, and Miss Bayonetta.
That's going to be a fun one.
Yep. But now, RB, I think it's time for the main event.
It is time for the main event. I am trying to see what the... I'm looking up the options to see what the most... Well, I mean, put it this way. It has to be a violent one.
For the bottom one, trust me.
Wait, let me check the bottom one. Oh, okay.
So, RB. Yes. During the self-aggrandizement deathmatch, there was one person in particular who really shone during that.
Yes.
With not only the most eliminations, but also the longest time spent in the self-aggrandizement deathmatch.
Yeah.
Travis Touchdown. And we were so impressed with him that we were going to give him a hell of a main event and a hell of a test to see if he is ready to go up into the big time. And going up against the what many could consider the face of hardcore nerdcore wrestling and a fellow scholar of the suplex, Thrash Panda.
Yes.
This is going to be a meeting of two of the most savvy suplex minds here in hardcore nerdcore wrestling. We are looking at at what I would like to call Crownless Tiger Thrashing Panda. This shit is going to pop off, and the best way we could think to make this pop off to get a proper setting for pure violence from two suplex machines is we make it a false count anywhere match. Because we want to see some suplexes on some fucking concrete, don't we, RB?
Oh, fuck yeah.
Alrighty. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, who you got?
Ooh, who do I got for this? See, ooh, that's a tough one, because the truth is this is going to be a big test for Travis. Especially, you know, with someone like Thrash. Again, Travis had an impressive showing. He's got the attitude. He's got the drive. But, I don't know, but Thrash Panda, he might want this one. He might want to get that belt back, especially from the Awoken, especially from Sonic, who's getting so close to trying to beat out Thrash's record.
Yeah.
So, honestly, you could go either way on this one.
I'm going to go with Travis. I think Thrash has been kind of on a bit of a downward run, and Thrash has the momentum.
You know what? I think I'm going to have to agree with you with this one, because I think more than anything, Travis might know how to play the mind game. Yeah. Really get into Thrash. Ash's head. But if Travis isn't careful, though, Thrash Panda going berserk is a dangerous Thrash Panda.
Yeah.
But I guess there's only one way to find out. Let's put these fuckers in the goddamn ring and see who's gonna come out.
Yeah, baby.
Free TV, folks, by the way. We're giving this to you on free fucking TV.
Exactly. We got to start the year off right.
And we are starting with an absolute bang. And coming in first, the No More Hero, the Crownless King, everyone's favorite otaku assassin, Travis Touchdown. But not to be outdone by the first ever hardcore nerdcore wrestling champion. The original fiercest fur, the punk rock pugilist, the mohawk murderer, Thrash Panda, tying up. Oh, both of them just out the gate. Oh, nice reversal from Travis. Oh, but Thrash reversing, and Travis responding with a reversal himself. Oh, Travis with the brain buster. Now taking Thrash into the corner, into a snapmare. Oh, Thrash cracking Travis with the side of the elbow. Oh, and a nice running bulldog from Travis, touchdown. You know, we're starting to see those mind games playing into this match. Thrash is having a hard time trying to keep his composure. And Travis is being able to capitalize on this, being able to reverse things easy, really get into Thrash's head. Oh, and Thrash with a nice snapmare, though.
Yeah, we're seeing a lot of conservative play here. Like, nobody's really going for anything quite yet. We're seeing a couple good snapmares, a couple good, like, throws to the turnbuckle, some nice chops, nice elbows, but nothing that's going to really build the momentum just yet. Oh! And Thrash with a power, yeah.
Oh, a nice knee drop from Travis. Because, again, what we're looking at here is a powder keg of maybe two competitors who might not have a history with one another, and this is just a pure just showcase ace of just unadulterated a grapple sports at its most violent.
I mean, of course.
And another running bulldog from Travis. Oh, Thrash able to reach the ropes though. Oh, and Travis with an elbow drop. Thrash is back up. Really taking it to Travis. Nice guillotine-like egg drop up from Thrash Panda into a belly to back. And already the suplexes are starting. I think, and the thing is, because this thing, RB, this match is a bit of a powder keg. You just need one little bit of spark, and things are going to start being set off, and you're going to start seeing bodies flying everywhere. Oh, Travis getting close to a suplex into the turnbuckle. Oh, not Thrash. Ash start to get the advantage. And Travis tossing Thrash to the outside of the ring. Taking some time to recuperate. Now again, remember, this is a false count anywhere match. They don't have to be pinned in the ring to lose. They could get pinned anywhere. The ramp, the outside of the ring, in the crowd, the parking lot, here on the commentary booth. Oh, and Thrash reversing the tombstone with a tombstone of his own. Oh, and a two leg drops too. Oh, but Travis bonding with the tombstone and going for the pin right away. Ooh, that's only good for a two count though. Oh, but Travis with the reversal. Oh, and a released German suplex sends Travis flying. Oh, Travis was in no man's land, but back into the ring he goes. Into a brain buster. Travis is going up. Ooh, what a moonsault. Oh, but Thrash Panda kicking out at two. Oh, into a belly to back onto Travis. Oh, and a big soccer kick to the back. Ooh, and into a eye suplex. But Travis responding in with a double underhook. Which, not to be confused with the Tiger Suplex. The Tiger Suplex is the you hook the arms behind the opponent.
Okay.
Because it's easy to confuse it because the Tiger Driver, you know, you kind of get them in the pedigree, and that's when you double on.
Right.
No, when it's like that, that suplex is a Jesus Christ, the fucking distance on that moonsault.
Almost like it was magnetized, and Fire Pro Wrestling is kind of a BS program.
So don't worry about it. Oh, Travis is going back up again. Into another heat-seeking moonsault. Oh, but Thrash Panda still kicking out at two. Oh, Thrash Panda responding with a raccoon driver.
It's a near fall.
There's a near fall. And Travis with the tombstone pile driver. That's only good for a two fall, though. Two count. And a belly-to-belly from Thrash. Oh, and into a Tiger Driver! I think that was a 98! Oh, but that's only good for a two count. Oh, and Thrash responding with a Raccoon Driver!
Oh! These men are giving their, like, best animal-themed drivers! It's who has the better driver!
There is going to be severe cervical damage to both of these men after tonight. Oh, but Thrash... Uh-oh, what's Thrash having set up? Oh, and Travis with the reversal. These men are putting their bodies on the absolute line. Oh, but but Thrash Panda responding with a belly to belly. Oh, and a released German suplex. Oh, Travis is back up. And Travis getting reversed. Oh, but Travis landing the tombstone. Is this gonna be it?
Only a two count.
The durability of Thrash Panda is nothing to be trifled with. They're just dumping each other on their heads. No, it's only good for a two count still. Oh, now Thrash Panda starting to manhandle Travis. Dropping Travis down into just multiple lariats. Oh, and another released German suplex sending Travis into the turnbuckle. Travis coming back up though. Oh, dodging out of the way of the lariat. Sending Thrash. Oh, but Thrash dodges out of the way of that. Oh, into a belly to back. Thrash really starting to pick up the pace right now. Oh, but Travis responding with a double underhook of his own. Oh, and into a folding powerbomb. And an elbow drop. Oh, but Thrash was back up. And Thrash with a brainbuster to the outside of the ring. Thrash really trying to get the crowd going. No, Thrash wants to finish this in the ring. Ooh, and then dumps Travis to the outside of the ring again. Thrash is just asserting his dominance, reminding people this is his house, but Travis is not. Oh God, Mr. Madoom is down.
Now is the time for the illegal shit to happen.
Oh boy, I love the illegal shit in wrestling. Oh, and finally Travis taking this to the outside. Into the tiger suplex on the outside. Oh, it's only good for a two count. And Travis getting sent into the barricades, into the ring, into the barricades again. Oh, and what an exploder suplex from Thrash Panda. And another exploder suplex from Thrash Panda. Oh, but Travis kicks out a two.
Oh my God.
And Travis sending Thrash Panda to the outside of the ring into another double underhook suplex and a lariat. Oh, Travis tombstone to the outside of the ring, the outside of the ring. Oh my God, the punishment these two are going through.
And a raccoon driver on the outside. Isn't it? It's it.
Oh, I think Thrash Panda passed out. I think that one took the last of Thrash's energy. He's not moving.
It's a five
as
star.
As it should be.
Yeah, as it should be. Oh,
my.
Man.
A great showing from both. And welcome back, Thrash Panda. Oh, my God. What a hell of a way to end the night, RB.
Yeah. I'm like super jazzed over that.
Oh my God, that was mwah, chef's fucking chef's kiss.
All right, well, yeah. So as let's see, I am currently out of a Switch because I sent in my Joy-Cons to get replaced. But if you want to donate, anyway, I'm going to see who's streaming right now. I believe iBolt07 is, let me just double check. There's not someone I pity more. Let's see. You know what? I think we're going to go with Zentrow, who is currently speedrunning Sly Cooper and the Thievius Raccoonus. You know what? I'll finish that tomorrow after... after Drag Race. That's going to be my post Drag Race game.
Sounds like a good plan.
Yeah, because you know you got to zig zag voodoo. It's not dig that voodoo. It's zig zag voodoo because he is zigging and zagging.
Right.
So I mean next week. I mean there's going to be the Ernie Loves Puns Trios Edition. There's going to be more undercard craziness. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's going to be more violence, but I really hope we do. So goodbye, everybody.
Bye-bye.